and is going to speak on a few different things and initiatives that the committee is working on addressing the development of the game, and especially tied to coaching. So I'll turn it over to Ross. Please help me welcome Ross Wedlake to the floor.
Thank you. Thank you. And I just realized we had the same last name. It's amazing. I never realized that. Thank you. I just got a few things that I want to mention. As Adam said, I'm on the board of Basketball Manitoba. And last year, the board decided to initiate a group that we have named the Technical Committee, and I'm chairing that. Now, we have met a number of times since then, and have started to look at the whole thing about what we can do to maybe make the game of basketball better in the province of Manitoba. And I'll say right from the beginning, and probably will end what I say with maybe the same statement, is that I think the basic principle we're working on is that everything we do, or everything we should do as coaches, is based upon what's good for the players that we are working with. It's not necessarily always good for us as coaches. Not maybe necessarily the best thing for parents. It may not necessarily be the best thing for referees, but it's best for the kids that we're working with. And that's whether they're this tall or this tall, or whether they're 5 years old or whether they're 25 years old in theory. Everything we're doing is in the interest of the players we're working with. And I hope we all agree with that statement. And what we have done, we've done a number of things, but the main thing that we spent looking at is the whole issue of making some modifications in the game. And in your clinic booklet, on page 305, there is a fairly detailed spreadsheet, and I'm not going to go through it here today by any means, and there is no time for questions, so that's good. I want to point out a few things on there. Now the first thing to mention is that this spreadsheet that you see there on page 305 is only a series of recommendations, because this group that we have, the technical committee, is a board-directed committee, but in theory really has very limited amount of power in terms of what we can do within the game. We are making recommendations. I should say that this committee is well represented from all levels of basketball. We have people from WNBA, we have club coaches, we have junior high and high school people, and we have university people and officials. So we're well represented. Now, some of the things that I do want to point out on here, if you look at it carefully, if you can understand it, is that there are some fairly major changes possibly coming. Now, the obvious question somebody might ask is, why is this happening? And the reason it's happening is, as we said, we think we can do better, basically. And there is something now out there that hopefully some of you are aware of, abbreviated as LTAD, Long-Term Athlete Development. And in a nutshell, what a long-term athlete development says is that we as coaches are better serving the athletes we're working with if we are working on basic athletic skills first and developing athletes before basketball players. And too often, not for anybody's, it's not a fault, but too often we possibly are in too much of a hurry to develop basketball players at a very young age. And maybe we need to develop athletes first. Now you can debate this, but the analogy I've used before is that this is much like the research that was on smoking. When I was a young person, I was young once, ladies. When I was a young person, they told us they thought smoking was bad for us. We weren't sure, but they thought it was. Now there's no debate. Smoking is bad for us. We know that. The research is the same in this area. You can't debate it any longer. That if we really want to develop good basketball players in the province of Manitoba, we need to spend more time working on basic athletic skills at a younger level and continuing on through. And the key part of LTAD is the long term. I think we as coaches, and I'm a coach too, we as coaches sometimes look at things very short term in terms of the season we have with these people. Instead of looking at it long term and what's going to be with these kids years from now. A, are they still going to be playing? And B, are their skills going to have improved? And I'm just a small piece of this puzzle. I am something that's going to help these kids develop long term. Now, if you look at the sheet that's in front of you there, there's a couple I will point out to you. You can see at the very young levels, we are recommending, and again, the word is recommending, we start playing possibly 3-on-3 and 4-on-4, and this would be width weights in the gyms. So rather than full court, width weights with some of the younger kids. The obvious question somebody would ask is why? Ask that question. Thank you, that's a good question. Basically, because what playing 3-on-3 we feel would do is put some more emphasis on basic offensive principles like spacing, ball and player movement, and all those things, rather than running offensive sets that sometimes we see kids running because coaches will go that way because they think they have to. We also think there would be more sharing of the ball and that more kids would handle the ball if there are only 3, maybe 4 players on the court at a time. We're also, as you can see, encouraging score not to be kept till a later level than it is now. One of the reasons there is because, again, we feel, and I hope you agree, that maybe we have too much emphasis on competition and not enough on training. And we need to put more emphasis on training kids rather than having them compete in games. Now we know a lot of this stuff, those first two that I just mentioned, is going to take some real education. Not only of the people in this room, myself included, but also people like parents and others. Because when they'll want to bring grandma out to the game and watch the game and they'll want to see lights on a board, that maybe say that their son or granddaughter won or lost, and that's how they equate basketball. So one of a recommendation that was made to me a while back, and we're going to talk about it at the next meeting in our committee, is that rather than leave some of you maybe, if when this stuff comes, and I think it will come, that when rather than leave you out on the hook, where somebody comes up to you after the game, a parent, as a volunteer coach, and says, how come we're doing this stuff? Like, what's going on here? And rather than leave you out on a limb, we're going to put together a one-page flyer that we'll make available to anybody that wants it. It will give some of the evidence and some websites that people can refer to and give people some information as to why this is. So you're not the one that's saying initiating this. But we really believe that we can do better, basically, as I said. And I will repeat again, all of it is based on the principles of that everything we do as coaches should be done in the interest of the people we're working with, in other words, the kids. Not to pad our resumes or win the banner, if that happens to be nice to put it, and it is nice to win those things. But in the long run, long-term development, what we're looking at doing is doing things that will improve the game of basketball within the province of Manitoba and also keep kids playing longer and keep kids playing, encourage kids to play the game at a higher level. We lose still too many kids. The WNBA has done a great job of getting lots of kids playing, but we still are at the higher level. We don't have a lot of those kids playing. We start asking ourselves why. And maybe we can do better in terms of keeping some of these kids involved. So there's possibly, and I shouldn't say possibly, there are some changes coming. And all I'm here to do today is get you to think about some of these things. There's also the whole question that's on there, and it's been debated in the past about no zones. Now, Reed Kenyon is here, and he can stand up for a minute. There he is, wave, everybody wave to Reed, yes. He is the assigning official for the WNBA. And he ends up, and often referees, and I do some refereeing myself, some of you have been unlucky enough maybe to have me refereeing some of your games, sometimes that the question of whether a team is playing a zone or not gets thrown onto the referee's shoulders. I believe, and I think Reed would agree, that shouldn't be the official's job. Like, I hope we believe that teaching kids how to guard somebody is important. and that we're not doing a service to young kids if we have them stand in a zone at a very young level. And the game becomes very stagnant, and there's very little, if any, learning that goes on. And so I hope that there's a spirit to that rule, and we could come out here right now and take some of these young ladies and show what a zone is, and whether it is a zone or isn't a zone, and how many feet you have to be away from, you know, because of all this. But we're not going to do that, because there's a certain spirit to that rule, as I said, that we believe that we got to teach people how to guard somebody. And this is my personal bias speaking now. I believe one of the reasons that sometimes we as coaches play zones is because it's easier to teach. And we don't have to teach somebody how to actually guard somebody because it's more difficult. And maybe you won't be as successful, but in the long run, you will help in the development of these kids' skills as basketball players. So we're going to leave the zone thing at that, in that if it is in the WNBA, at certain levels, no zones. Sure, there's help sign. Sure, you have to, it's not like you have to be standing next to your person at all moments, but you have to be guarding somebody. And we'd rather not have the referees be asked to determine. Now, for me, maybe, I'm not saying I'm the greatest official in the world, because I'm not. But, you know, like, I've seen a lot of basketball. And maybe for me it's not that big a deal. But you know that for some of the younger officials, they have enough difficulty worrying about the rules of the game and calling fouls and violations and all those things, rather than having to be asked for coaches whether this is a zone or not. Now, if you really believe somebody is, I guess that's the convener's job to deal with. But we'd rather that not be directed towards the officials, and we all agree that this is something that isn't better for the game and better for the kids. Not to play zone, but have people playing man-to-man. By the way, Reed mentioned that if you ever want to get a hold of him, he has his own email, and it's ref@wmba.ca. And any questions or anything you have of him about officials or about anything that you think that he could help you with, I'm sure he'd be happy to communicate with you through email. So it's refref@wmba.ca. So I don't want to take a lot more time other than to say that the technical committee is going to keep meeting. Our next meeting is actually on Tuesday of this next week. It's at 5 o'clock and it's at the New Sport Manitoba building in room 4, in room 4 of the lower level. If you want to come, you're welcome. This is not City Hall. You know what I mean? You can come in and take part and get involved in the discussion. We'd be happy to see you. And what we're going to start looking at, we're going to keep reviewing a lot of these things that I've just talked about, but one of the things we're going to start looking at is the whole issue of practices to games in terms of a ratio. Like, what is the situation out there right now in terms of how many games are people playing, as opposed to how many practices are they having? And we don't know what the situation is right now. Some of us think we can guess, and sometimes we feel that possibly there are too many games and not enough practices. And we have to put more emphasis, as we said, on training rather than on competition. But again, that's a process of education for everyone, including not just you people in this room, but coaches that aren't here, for the players and for the parents, for the referees, for everybody that's involved directly or indirectly with the game. So all I really wanted to make you aware of the fact that this stuff is being discussed. There are some recommendations that are there in front of you that will be coming. And again, it's up to leagues like the WNBA. It's up to organizations like the Manitoba High School Athletic Association if this stuff never does happen. And we're going to keep working to try to do it. And again, if you want to know why, it's because we think we can do better. And again, we think that everything we do should be done in the interest of the kids we are working with, rather than for the interests of others. Now, the last thing I'd like to do here, and these young ladies said they would assist in this endeavor, so they're actually going to do this. I have a survey here that we would like to distribute, and we'd like you to complete it right now and give it back to us right now. All you have to do is circle things on this. You don't have to write anything. You don't have to put your name on it. If you want to write a comment at the bottom, feel free. But all you have to do is circle. It basically, what it says is what level are you coaching, and then the ages of the kids, how many games might you play. If you don't know, take your best guess. And there's some ranges there to circle. And how many practices and how long are the practices. So we're just trying to collect some information. So if these young ladies would now jump up. And they're going to distribute and collect this thing. So I don't know, do it any way you can, please. And then when you come back, please bring them back to me.
I don't know how many here, what kind of do this. We're trying to get everybody up there. So everybody gets one.
I would bet, I know Mike is on next, and I bet he's going to have, he will probably tell you the truth rather than what I said, but he'll have a few comments in regards to this also, because I've heard him speak, and I think, I hope that he would agree with the direction that we're taking in this. So I'll congratulate all of you for being here today and making the sacrifices what it is. Because I'm sure we all could think of other things we could or should be doing, and the fact that we're here today means that we are hoping to improve ourselves as coaches, and that's great. And we're doing this again. You're sitting here because you know you want to do as good a job for the kids that you're working with. So my congratulations to all of you. All the best to you this year. I hope your season goes well. I hope you're not lucky enough or unlucky enough to have me as an official. But if it works out that way, I'll be happy to talk to you about any of this stuff. So please fill in the survey and give it back to the young ladies, and we'll get back to you with more information in the future. Thank you.